Welcome to worship on this Baptism of Our Lord Sunday, where we hear the same voice that Jesus did, naming us beloved and chosen of God. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. Holy God, holy and merciful, holy and mighty, you are the river of life. You are the everlasting wellspring. You are the fire of rebirth. Glory to you for oceans and lakes, for rivers and streams. Honor to you for cloud and rain, for dew and snow. Your waters are below us, around us, above us. Our life is born in you. You are the fountain of resurrection. Praise to you for your saving waters. Noah and the animals survived the flood. Hagar discovers your well. The Israelites escape through the sea, and they drink from your gushing rock. Naaman washes his leprosy away, and the Samaritan woman will never be thirsty again. At this font, holy God, we pray. Praise to you for the waters of baptism and for your word that saves us in this water. Breathe your spirit into all who are gathered and into all creation. Illumine our days, enliven our bones, dry our tears, wash away the sin within us, and drown the evil around us. Satisfy all our thirsts with your living water, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Holy God, creator of light and giver of goodness, your voice moves over the waters. Immerse us in your grace and transform us by your Spirit, that we may follow after your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. A reading from Acts. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" They replied, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Well, today we celebrate baptism of our Lord. And our reading from Mark is at the very beginning. And instead of a birth narrative in Mark, we get a baptism narrative that starts us off. There's a number of places I think that we can focus in on like this as a beginning. But I want to think first about how this begins Jesus' ministry. Jesus, there's 2 points here. Jesus is starting in baptism, joining others in this rite of repentance, and he is also starting hearing a promise from God. This act of repentance is something that John has been gathering crowds to come to him in this edge of the wilderness to confess their sin, to maybe begin something new in their lives. And Jesus comes and joins it. And I think the scholars tend to not know exactly where to take that. You know, can we say Jesus had sinned before this and needs some repentance? Can we say, you know, who knows, I guess, what exactly? But I think that sense of solidarity of Jesus with the people who recognize that something needs to change and being open to that humility, coming to John, who John, you know, in our text is like, I'm this one who's coming is more worthy than me and all that. And yet Jesus kind of submits himself to be below John, to be accepting John's work of repentance. The other side of the baptism, then after he's coming out of the water, we have Jesus having this vision and hearing this voice. And so Jesus hears the Father say, "You are my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." And I think what a powerful beginning for anyone, and especially for Jesus. You know, he's starting with affirmation. And it's not affirmation really based on anything he's done. And I think that's really key for us, because a lot of times I think we look at, oh, we can feel good about accomplishing something. But we don't often begin the day with a sense of our own goodness and worth. Mm-hmm. And just accept that that worth is a given. And here Jesus, at the beginning of his ministry, hasn't done anything worth the gospel writer writing about. Here's God's affirmation, "With you I am well pleased, and I am claiming a relationship with you. You are my Beloved." And so Jesus goes out as a leader, solidarity with the people, and affirmation from God. And I think that's just a really neat place to begin.
It is, and it makes me think about our own sacrament of baptism and how we put so much emphasis on this is God's promise for this child, that this child shares in the same promise as Jesus of being beloved, but then also, just like with the baptism that Jesus experiences in the river, it's a beginning of a new way of life. As it is for those that we baptize as part of our church life. You know, sometimes I think we get too caught up in the sort of promised aspect of baptism and not enough in this is the beginning of a new way of life. And as we see from Jesus, when he gets baptized, he moves on and all of a sudden he's part of a ministry of healing people, of driving out the evil that possesses people. He feeds those who are hungry. He forgives, which is basically saying he offers unconditional welcome to those that the world pushes aside. And so this being named Beloved, the solidarity with the people, you know, drives and sends him to be part of what God is doing in the world. And it's the same for us when we're baptized, that we take those, we tend to gloss them over. I think sometimes those are responsibilities, you know, that we ask of parents and sponsors and the faith community, that all in their own way try to touch on what's happening here. Yes, God loves you. God cares for you. You are beloved of God. But you're about to become part of something going on in the world, part of God's love and welcome being extended to all, that you're going to strive for justice and peace. You're going to care for the world that God made. This is who you are going to be.
And I wonder if feeling ourselves connected to what happened to Jesus in his baptism might help us live out those promises better. You know, if we have a sense that we, being connected in the waters of baptism, receive the same belovedness and affirmation from God as Jesus received from the Father, then maybe that gives us the power to live out those promises, to work for justice even as we see it being thwarted, to reach out in love to others, not knowing if it will be returned to us, to continue to proclaim the radical love of God in a world that's jaded and can't imagine something undeserved being gifted to them. So we're recording this while our Capitol buildings are being occupied.
Yeah. Little coup d'etat. Epiphany coup d'etat.
Yeah. So what does the gospel have to say to Christians in the midst of a tumultuous world, of leaders who aren't so ready to give up power, or of a whole global crisis, a health crisis, economic crisis, and violence being commonplace all around the world, not something maybe we've experienced ourselves as much. But
yeah, I connect in a way through that lens with our reading from Genesis.
Okay.
You know, we got the first like 5 verses of Genesis here
little
today.
Little
sneak peek of Genesis. Genesis is at its root protest literature.
Hmm.
It's this new, the creation story in Genesis 1 was created and told and recorded when God's people were in a faraway land in Babylon, taken over by this imperial power. And they created it as a way to try to keep their heritage alive, to remember who they are called to be by God. The way that they claim that identity is not through violence. That's exactly what they see going on among the Babylonians, who are taking over cultures and countries with violence and exploitation and injustice. Instead, their response to remember who they are is to create art and to tell these stories where God creates the world without any violence at all. In like Babylonian tales, you know, it's like Marduk and Tiamat, and there's like war, and there's this tearing apart of a carcass that God create, that, you know, the gods create the world through this violence. But in this story, in Genesis, God speaks and things come into being. There is no, yeah, I'm going to tear this body of my enemy apart, and that makes the sky and the ground and that sort of mythology. And so even as we see, you know, this kind of attempted coup d'etat and these protesters, there are calls for violence. There's calls for overthrows. And that's not how God creates the world anew. God creates the world anew through water, through claiming us with a promise and sending us forth to be people of justice who live in a way like those people, God's people in Babylon had to live, in a way that's quite set apart from the rest of the world and its ways of injustice and exploitation.
So I wonder, I mean, as a people who are grounded in that art that was created so long ago, of this alternative narrative of creation out of word and with successive refrains of it was good, it was good, it was good, you know, and then you get to the mark of you are my beloved. You know, what does it mean for us to be a people where those are the refrains that should be core to our identity? It was good, you are beloved. And that also help us to see our neighbor, to look at others who may hold very different opinions and different policy agendas than us, and to look at them and still say, you are good, you are beloved. You know, how do we recognize that? How does that change our own actions? And how might that help draw all of our actions together into something different, where it's not the violence, the winners and losers, and I have to be right and you have to be wrong, and it has to be all my way. And could there be something that's not your way or my way, but a way forward together that is about the well-being of the whole creation, that we can all work towards together?
And I see that in this ministry of Jesus that starts with his baptism. You know, when folks came to John for baptism, you see this in some of the other gospels where John talks about God's winnowing fork is in his hand, and things like that, that there's this violent apocalyptic imagery that's used, that many folks who are following John and others in the culture of the time think, you know, hey, God is going to do something. The world's about to change, and it's going to come with fire and brimstone and this, that, and the other. But then what we see in Jesus then that follows isn't a ministry of judgment. It's a ministry of welcome and compassion and healing, that ends up with him on the cross as a victim of violence rather than one who, you know, judges the world with violence.
Yeah, John and Jesus are contrasted in the Gospels sometimes. John's disciples do this, Jesus' disciples look like they're just chilling and hanging out. You know, what's that all about? And how then that expectation, a lot of the Gospels about expectations put in on Jesus and Jesus not following expectations, all the way from this baptism, this act of repentance, all the way to the cross and the violence that's met by him not playing according to the rules, and part of that game of outsider insider violence stuff, and then he just takes that violence in on himself. And Mark especially, you get just a strange ending, you know. It's Jesus is dead, the tomb is empty, none of this is according to plan. What is it?
And they were afraid.
Yeah.
So then we can find in baptism, if we find a way in which our baptism is linked to Jesus' baptism, that those words of belovedness are spoken to us as they were to Jesus, and it sets us on a path toward joining God and the things that God is doing to bring life and light to the world. For crazy times like this with pandemics and coups and all this kind of stuff, like, this is a time to claim anew, not only am I beloved, but as you said, my neighbor is good. When God creates things, God says, it is good. It is very good. We can walk through the world in a different way, like those seeking John's baptism, like those who wrote Genesis in a time of oppression. We can become a contrast kind of people and say, hey, folks are going to demonize neighbors. We're going to say, along with God, no, they are good. They are very good. When folks single you out for one reason or another, you can remember, I am beloved. God's promise spoken to me in my baptism is that I am a child of God, marked with the cross of Christ and sealed by the Holy Spirit forever. And those are powerful words to guide our life.
And I think, though, it's good to have the twin points in what we see in Jesus, in Mark here, of both celebrating our belovedness and our goodness, and also recognizing our need for repentance. Because I think that you can be beloved and you can still take wrong action that hurts the creation, that hurts our neighbor. And so how do we have the humility to hear where we're going in the wrong direction, to hear the consequences of our actions, and have the ability to shift our path? You know, if that's what John's baptism and repentance, you know, and we talk about repentance being about shifting our path, you know, yes, we're always held in God's belovedness, but sometimes our path is leading toward death. And how do we allow our neighbors, how do we allow our church, how do we allow the public discourse to help us open our eyes to see what we're doing and the impact of what we're doing and who we're being, so that we can change that and live more into the nurturing of the belovedness and the goodness of others.
Dear friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism as we come before God to make public affirmation of baptism into Christ. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you that you have made us your own by water and the word and baptism. You have called us to yourself, enlightened us with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished us in the community of faith. Uphold us and all your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God? I renounce them. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. You have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. People of God, do you promise to support and pray for one another in your life in Christ? We do, and we ask God to help and guide us. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. Stir up in your people the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Giving thanks for the gift of God's belovedness given to us in baptism, and for the calling given to us to be people who care for God's earth and who strive for justice and peace, who are committed to the way of Jesus Christ, I invite you to send in or set aside an offering, bring it by the church mailbox or send it through the mail as an expression of your generosity for all that God has done in your life and that all that God is about to do. On this Sunday of the baptism of our Lord, let us offer our prayers for all in need, responding to each petition with words from today's psalm, "Give us your blessings of peace." For the worldwide church, for those who minister in the church, for all who will be baptized this year, and for their godparents and sponsors, that the Holy Spirit will empower all the faithful for lives of service, let us pray. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. For the waters of the earth, for the seas, the lakes, the rivers, for the wells that provide drinking water, and for the water that is piped into our homes, that God provide clean and nourishing water for all living things, let us pray. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. For the nations of the world and their leaders, for the United States in the midst of civil unrest and turmoil, for our elected leaders and their families, for police officers, for peacemakers, and for the health of relationships with other nations, that God will fill us with courage and strength for these days, let us pray. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. For our nation facing the evil of white supremacy, for those lured by hatred and violence, for all dealing with new and lasting trauma, for prophets who proclaim uncomfortable truths, but as your beloved creation, God, inspire all people to work for the harmonious well-being of others. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. For students, for teachers and school administrators, for parents assisting their children in homeschooling, and for young people who are finding a way to graduation, that as the academic year resumes, give resilience to everyone in the search for education. Let us pray. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. For all who are in want, trouble, or sickness, for the countless who are suffering with COVID-19, for medical workers, for people who are hungry or homeless, imprisoned or lonely, and for those that we name before you now. That God grant these ones health and wholeness to a world so filled with pain. Let us pray. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. For ourselves, that we rejoice in our adoption as members of God's family, and that now in this silence we bring to God our heart's requests. Let us pray. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. In gratitude for our beloved dead, we offer our praise for all the baptized who have accompanied us and supported us and taught us throughout our days, that at our end, we join with them in everlasting joy. Let us pray. O God, give strength to your people. Give us your blessings of peace. Almighty and most merciful God, you are the mighty voice from heaven. You are our beloved Savior. You are the descending dove. We give you thanks for all your goodness and tender mercies, and we ask you to accept our prayers for the sake of your mercy, today and forever. Amen. We pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God the Creator, strengthen you, Jesus the Beloved, fill you, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.
Thank you.
be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.